Hello.
This episode
I'm going to talk about how I got a job in Thailand, working in Bangkok, living in Bangkok, having a girlfriend in Bangkok, losing my job or quitting my job in Bangkok, and then why I left. So how I got the job. Right. So I was leaving UK. I've become registered, decided to leave the UK. And I was heading to Australia. I got a working visa to work in Australia. I applied for this migration visa to work in Australia, which takes a couple of years. But I had if you're under 21, I think, or under 30, I can't remember, you can apply for a working holiday visa, allows you to work in Australia for a year. So I left the UK. I went to Cairo, visit a friend. I went to Thailand. It was just supposed to be a couple of weeks. I was going to go to Thailand for before I went to Australia. This is when I left England. So it must have been about 13 years ago. Became registered architect, left England. I thought, right, I'm going to leave. I was heading to Australia to work there, but I ended up just going on holiday to Thailand. And just for a week, I was in Bangkok for a few days. And then I went around some islands and stuff. I really liked it. And I thought, I wonder if I could get a job here, as an architect. And I went online and have a look, and I found this agency. They're asking for, senior designer for this firm in Bangkok. I'm not going to say which firm it was, but it's quite a big international design firm. Did a lot of architecture and interior work. So I applied for that. It's through an agency. I don't know what the name of the agency, nothing big. And literally, they called me the next day. I think they replied to email, and they called me the next day because I had a local telephone number, had a local Thai number. So they called me on that. That helps if you're there. This is what I say to people: if you want to find a job in a foreign country, you got to be there, and you got to have a local number for people to call you. So. So they called me and said, yeah, they're interested. And then he contacted the company, and they wanted to have an interview. So at this point, I think I was in Krabi, down south it was. I was in Bangkok for about 5 or 6 days. Then I went down south to these islands, and they called me there and said, come for an interview. No, actually, it was in Bangkok. Just before I left, they said, come for an interview in... And I didn't want to have one there, and then I thought, I'll have one in 4 days when I come back from the islands. So, and give me a bit of time to prepare. So I went to the islands and then came back for the interview to Bangkok. And I had the interview, it went quite well. And yeah, they offered me the job, literally to start in a week. It was more interior design work, more than architecture. There was a senior guy, he was Australian, he was an interior designer really, and there was some Thai people in the team, about 4 people. It was the hospitality team. So I got that job and started in a few days. So now on to working in Bangkok. So yeah, it's international company, so there was a big boss who's Indian, and there's my team leaders, Australian, and the other guys were Thai. And at this time, it's mostly AutoCAD we're using, and but it's mostly my boss, who was the Australian guy, he was doing all the interior. It was refurbishment work. There was a car park in a hospital, and one of the car park floors in the hospital was getting converted into a hospital floor. They already did loads of floors already. It looked really nice. It was a hotel, hospital in Bangkok. It's like a really posh hospital. All the sheikhs from Dubai go there. So they designed a lot of the floors. It's interior work. So I couldn't understand what they did, because it was interiors, refurbishment. Okay, what did you design here? But it's really nice. Mostly lighting and furniture and stuff like that. And yeah, it was really weird, because I was designing furniture, FF&E schedules. It wasn't really my thing, but I was prepared to do it, because hey, it's I've got a job in Bangkok, it was great. So it's more a senior interior designer role really, and I didn't really have much experience in that. But yeah, I wasn't really. It was mostly the Australian guy that was doing all the concept design work, and you more or less draw it up really and do the detail technical drawings and stuff. But yeah, it was a bit strange, like a lot of furniture design. And yeah, I learned a lot about materials, veneer, laminate and stuff like that. Anyway, so I've been working there about a year or less than that, and then I come up before I come into like the bad part. It's like, phew, what happened? But working in Bangkok. So living in Bangkok, Jesus Christ, it's an amazing place. That you'd never get bored in that place. It's got everything. It's got like fun, nightlife, there's stuff to do. You can go to islands if you've got enough time, or go to the country weekends if you have time. And the frigging girls there, Jesus Christ, they're frigging hot. I know there's ladyboys, but like the girls there are hot as well. Like, I mean, I'm like young and like walking to work, and like, oh, the girls are so hot, like walking around. It's like if you're a guy, that place will eat you alive, some of the places there. Not just Bangkok, there's other places like Pattaya and stuff. God, those places, they'll eat your soul if you're a single guy and you're at those places. Those places will eat you alive, I'm telling you. You have to be really careful at those places. If you're a young guy going to like Thailand, you have to be careful. But like, you can have a hell of a lot of fun. But I didn't really hang around the expat areas that much, really. I still went to the touristy areas at weekends, and so much fun. Like, oh geez, you never get bored of that place. Anyway, it's like some of the best times of my life, and some of the worst times of my life as well, which you'll find out later. And I go on to I kind of left the job. So I had a girlfriend after a while. I had a girlfriend and we were together. Oh, what a nightmare, man. So my first paycheck, she stole my first paycheck. Can you believe that? So I hardly had any money. I finally got some money, my first paycheck. She took it because I didn't have a bank at that time. So they gave me a check and they paid me by cash when I cashed the check out. So I hid that in my drawer and she took it and she left. And me being young and naive, she was like, all these excuses. I took her back. I was stupid. What an idiot. And then like, she said she'll give me the money back. So then I continued working. I was staying with her. And then like, the Christmas came up and we went to this place called Chiang Mai, which is up north in the mountains and stuff. It's where they filmed the Rambo movies. And then had this motorbike. Another stupid thing. Rented out a scooter. Went up to this spring in the mountains. Like, Jesus Christ, it's like 45 minutes an hour drive on this scooter up in the mountains. I'd never even driven a scooter before. On the way back, crashed, had an accident. Didn't break any bones, but got like, nearly died. It was pretty scary. Like my hand, there was like ripped a lot of skin off it, and like a big hole in my hand. Went to hospital, they had to like bandage it. Just a lot of grazes on my knees and legs. And same with my girlfriend, she was on the back. She wasn't as bad as me though. So it's bandaged up and everything, and it got infected. My hand, this big hole about the size of about half the size of a golf ball. Like flesh completely gone off my hand. I didn't think I'd be able to write again or draw again. It was pretty scary. So I had I called up my work and said I won't be in for a week. And then a couple of weeks, I finally went back to the hospitals around were awful. Like, and I had to get my hand like cleaned every day, like clinics and stuff. And it like got infected and all this green shit came out of it. And every day I had to go to this clinic and they'd put this bandage on. And like, they always put this crappy bandage that would stick, like this net bandage. And every day I had to get it cleaned and they'd rip it off and it fucking hurt. Like pulling off half your, the wound would come with it. And then like doing that every day for weeks. And then we went, and then she would take this, my girlfriend would take me to these shitty hospitals or shitty clinics. Something to do with like, she wouldn't, because her friends would tell her, don't take him to this hospital because the girls are pretty there. So she took me all to all these shitty clinics, shitty hospitals with all the ugly nurses. And it's all crappy. They didn't even have, and then one time they put this bandage on that was good. It didn't pull the skin off when they ripped. It was like clean the next day. It didn't hurt. And like every hospital I went to, they wouldn't have it. Go, oh, none in stock. Like fucking hell. And like she took kept going to these shitty clinics. Then I went to, and then my called my up my work and said I'll be coming in next week. He told me to go to this Christian hospital, which was a decent hospital. So I went there. My girlfriend wouldn't tell me not to go there. I got pissed off of her. So I went there and like it's so much better. They had all the bandages and everything. They made it all clean. Like fucking go into all these shitty clinics for like weeks and like fucking her and then listening to her like fuck. Anyway, I went back to work and I did think the boss was that like he didn't think I was that bad. Like I'd never been that injured before, so I was a bit of a pussy, so I kind of took it the wrong way and I went in and said I'll be in a couple of days. I think you got a bit suspicious or something. I don't know. But so I finally went back to work. Excuse me. Worked a couple of days. And I noticed the other guys on my team. The Australian boss guy, he wasn't around. That was another thing. Just before I had the accident, when I joined, they said, oh, we won't throw you in the deep end, blah, blah, blah. We'll gradually let you in and gradually teach you the ins and outs of the place and stuff. After 2 weeks of being there, they said the Australian guy boss was leaving and I had to kind of replace him. I was like, I just didn't know that. And he goes, oh, you'll be thrown in the deep end. He's like, when I joined the company, he said, you won't be thrown in the deep end. Then like literally 2 weeks later, he goes, you'll be thrown in the deep end. The guy's leaving. Anyway, so by the time I had the accident, I went back to the place after a couple of days. The rest of the team members were like having discussions with, I could see them in the conference room. They were having like meetings with the big managing director, this Indian guy. And they were talking about me, I think. And the deal was, I think they were going to get me a work permit. Once you've been there a year or 6 months, you get a temporary one and then they'll get you a permanent one. So waiting for that to come through. And then, so they called me in after I had the accident and came back working after a few days. And they said, it's a bit weird. They took me into a conference room and they said, so we've talked to everyone. It goes, what we'd like to do is like offer you half. We've got your work permit. We're going to offer you literally half the salary. Plus, we just want you to be like a CAD manager or something like that, like not a, like a designer. So I was like, what? I didn't quite get what they were talking about. And they kept saying it to me. And I was like working out like, geez, the salary is like, they've got a work permit. It's like they got like negotiating, like you got this work permit now. Okay, we got a work permit for you. But now you're going to get half the salary. So I was going to have a pissed off, and I said, "Nah, not really," and I said, "I don't really agree with this." And he goes, "Why not?" He goes, "I don't want to be like a CAD guy, and look at the salary you're giving me now. This is," I said, and I started to lose my temper a little bit, which is a big mistake. I learned never to do that again. So they went off. I was still in the conference room. They came back. They said, "Okay, you can leave then." I said, "But you must sign this." And I was reading it, and it was like basically saying, I'll leave and I won't sue the company. That's what it basically said. I said, I was like, it was, but it was like different worded differently, like blah 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 blah. But that's what it basically meant. Because it meant like I will not sue the company. And that's when I started getting a bit angry. I was like saying, I don't agree with any of this. Like I'm not signing this. And like the girl that was with the managing director said, like, oh, you must sign that. I go, no, I don't. So they went off, like, left me in the conference room. They came back again, and they had a check. So they offered me, like, it was something like 3 or 4 months of my original salary to sign that letter saying I will not sue them and then just leave. So basically they were offering me to stay there. They offered me to stay and I can continue working there for, like, half the salary. Or I could take four months salary, maybe, or like nearly double the amount. So there's like equivalent to at least six months pay. Yeah, that was it. So it was like either work there for 6 months or just get 6 months pay and leave. So I decided I just signed it and got 6 months. So they like paid me off basically. So I got 6 months salary, or it was like 3 months of my original salary. And I thought to myself, oh, fuck these guys. I can get a job here easily. I was only here like a week. I already got a job. There's loads more companies in Bangkok. So I just left. And then they were pissing around. They had to get rid of my work permit, all this paperwork. They were doing that. They're trying to sort that out. And I was playing around. They had my passport, and they wouldn't give me my passport back until I sorted out the work permit exit and stuff. Anyway, after that was a bit nasty, that bit. But after that, I thought, oh, I'll get a job easy. Big mistake. I had so many interviews, like, went on for months. I saw just about all the big firms in Bangkok all wanted to interview me, but they didn't offer me a job. I think it was to do with the work permit. It's like a miracle I got that job. I didn't realize, like, they had all these interviews that would go really well, blah blah blah, and at the end it goes, so what about your work permit? It goes, I haven't got one, you got one. And they just like, oh, they were like that. But hardly anyone would fucking reply as well. You'd have an interview, and they wouldn't fucking reply. Or they go, we'll let you know. And they wouldn't reply. It's like, pisses you off, like, doing that. I must have had at least 10, 15 interviews. All the big firms in Bangkok. It's just a shame. I think it was just the work permit thing. There was one guy, like, offered to do freelance. So, but, like, that was just weird. I don't think it was me. They're all interested. There was even one guy who interviewed me. He used to study at Huddersfield University. He was a student there. He worked there. He was one of the team leaders or something. I thought I was going to get a job there, but like, I didn't hear back from them either. I had to like write to them several times, go, oh, what happened and stuff. Yeah, I should have. Like, if you ever have an interview, make sure you find out the reason why. Because I don't know. All I can think of was the work permit. And then, like, for some weird reason, I ended up applying for a university job. It's like the top architecture, Chulalongkorn University in Bangkok. They offered me a job, but like, oh my god, My girlfriend at the time, she's going, you want to work at university, huh? You want to fuck a pussy, huh? She's like beating the shit out of me, saying you're not going to work there. And like, she was making sure I wouldn't work there. She's she wouldn't let me work there. I should have got rid of that fucking girl. So she ruined that for me. She's like, she wouldn't let me work there. At least it was a job until I found another job. So it's like 6 months now. I didn't have a job. So she ruined that. So I thought I might work at the university for a bit. I didn't really want to do it. I didn't want to work at university, but it was the only thing that came up. So there's that. And then So I screwed that up because she screwed that up for me. And then I had another interview with this firm. They seemed really interested, but I had a big fight with my girlfriend and I had like freaking bruises on my face and like there's like blood coming out of my mouth. She went to this interview. It's on the way to the interview. She, like on a boat or something. And I jumped off the boat and left her on the boat and like went to my interview. And that went there. But the interview went quite well. But I don't know. So I didn't get that job. And then it got really bad. I started running out of money. And she said she was going to give me money back from the money she stole from me. So I never got that back. And then I had no money whatsoever. And then she was basically, I had to leave my apartment because I got chucked out of there because I couldn't pay the rent anymore. So I had a condo with a swimming pool. That didn't last long after I lost my job. Then I had to check into these guest houses you pay every day. And I was there for a while and she started paying for the room because I was broke. I ran out of money completely and I couldn't even leave the country. And I was going on visa runs for a while. They cost money. Then I couldn't afford the visa run, so I overstayed my visa for like months and months. And I was worried about the police catching me, put in the detention center. I couldn't pay for the rooms, for the hotel rooms, guest house rooms. She was paying for a while. I don't know how the fuck she wasn't even working. I don't know what she was doing to getting money. She kept saying she was going to inherit money from her parent, from her brother-in-law or something. That's what I was waiting for, the money so I could do something. And then we had another argument and like she ripped up my passport. So not only overstay my visa, she ripped up my passport. So I couldn't even get a passport now. I couldn't even afford to get a new passport. So I had to call my parents up. They gave me a bit of money, but they only give me like $100, and that would last me like a week or 2 weeks at the most. And then I'd run out, and then like she was paying for it went on for ages. You know, I kept asking my parents to send me money on like Western Union. And then they thought I was on drugs, so they stopped sending me money, my parents. And there's like points where I was like in a park, didn't know where I was going to stay that night, but managed to get a room. So that's probably the lowest point of my life. That was pretty bad. And then, so I must have been there a year, overstaying my visa, not having a job, like stuck in a room, like reading books and stuff, because I had no money at all, maybe just for two meals a day and on the street and stuff. It was just terrible. That's like really bad point in my life. But that kind of thing, like you look back at that and you think how good your life is now. So how I got out of that, let's look at what I'm going to talk about next. I talked about that. So this is how I left the place. So I got an email. So after all this shit, I got an email saying my Australian visa came through. It's been like 2 years now since I applied. And it said I had to get like a chest scan in the hospital for the health inspection thing. So I begged my parents for my money, my dad wouldn't send me money, or my mum, or anyone. But they offered to send me a flight to UK, but I didn't want to go back to the UK. So I had a friend who moved to Perth, Australia, and he offered to stay there if I got to Australia. So all I had to do is get to Australia, really, basically. And then I think I could do it. So I managed to convince my dad to get me a flight to Australia and some money for the health thing, which wasn't that much. I did that and I got out of there and said goodbye to that crazy girl. There's other shit that happened with that crazy girl. She got pregnant like three times. She had to get an abortion. I don't know if she'd say this, I might cut it out, I don't know. But I don't even know if she was actually pregnant or not, because she could have been lying just to get the money. Cause that was the other thing, I had to try and get money from parents with that. It's fucking bad times, man. And then, like, God, there's so many things that happened, like, terrible. Went to a village for a while because the brother-in-law had a big tobacco business, and she was supposed to give me my money back. She never did. Like, that went on for months. It's like literally like dangling a carrot in front of me. Next week, I'll give you the money. Next week, give you the money. Next month, I'll give you the money. Next week, I just need the money so I can get out of this country. Just went on, literally went on for a fucking year. Ugh. Anyway, got out of that place, got the flight. And then I was worried when I left the country that they're going to check my passport. Like, overstayed my visa 1 year. Because I got the money for the passport as well. My parents got me money for a new passport. Before that, I went to the embassy and I asked them. This guy came in this room and he said, "You better watch out. You've overstayed your visa. There's a cop outside. If they catch you, they'll put you in the detention center." So I was like shitting myself. That's when I first went to the embassy to ask them about my situation. But then I got one of my father gave me money for the flight back to Australia. And I can't remember if my mother gave me something, because my parents are divorced. So basically, I got enough money for the healthcare scan, get a new passport, and a flight to Australia. They bought me the flight, didn't give me cash. So I had those three things. Once I had those three things, I got out of the country. And I was worried when I got to the airport. Jesus Christ. Because she said she knew, the girlfriend I had, she said she knew somebody who worked at the airport to bribe them so they'd let me get out of the country when I leave. But she went to meet some guy. I didn't go with her. And I don't know if that was bullshit as well, because she said, like, he's going to leave the country. Just let him leave. Don't put him in the detention center. So when I went to the airport, I showed all my passport, and she took me to this, it's bad, it was the airport. I was wanting to leave the country, and the lady saw my passport, and it overstayed my visa, like, 1 year, like, illegally, and, like, he took me in this other room, this guy, and I started crying, and, like, they let me through. They just saw me and they just let me through. And I gave the phone to her, and my girlfriend was like, "Just let him go." She was crying, "Just let him go, please let him go. Let him have a good life," or something she was saying. That's what she said afterwards. And then they let me go and I left the country. Got to Australia, and like I literally sorted myself out within 6 months. I paid everything off and like had a car and I had a good job and sorted myself out. So that's the story of an architect working and living in Bangkok.